On the Zero Hour, I am always your host and remain so, Richard R.J. Eskow. The program is called The Zero Hour for several reasons, one of which is that we are out of time to do something about climate change, and by something I mean something very, very big. Just a few headlines that I picked up right before we went on the air. Mega heat wave, is peaking in the West, breaking records and intensifying droughts and fires. That's one headline. Another, climate change batters the West before summer even begins. Another, NASA says Earth now trapping unprecedented amount of heat, and it's doubled in just 15 years. Another, an eighth of the human population is sweltering under a record-breaking heat dome. Climate change is making it worse. That's just the United States. The world overall is even more of a horrific story. Joining us once again is Professor Richard Wolff. You know Richard Wolff's work from Economic Update, Tuesday evenings on Free Speech TV, from Democracy at Work .info, and from his many books, the latest of which is The Sickness is the System. He's an economist and professor. Without any further ado, Richard Wolff, welcome back to the program.
Thank you, RJ. I'm glad to be here and talking with you again.
Likewise. And okay, let's get right to it. I listed, you know, some of the critical issues we're facing. Another headline today, we record on Thursdays, Senate Democrats are considering a sweeping roughly $6 trillion reconciliation package that could advance key elements of President Biden's infrastructure plan, including something for climate change. So I guess my first question to you, as an economist, as a historian of economics, and as an observer of society, to a lot of people, $6 trillion with a chunk of it for climate change sounds like a lot of money. It seems to me maybe it's not nearly enough to do the job. But what are your thoughts?
Yes, well, I'm beyond making the comment, although it's correct, that this is too little and too late. I think almost anyone paying attention who isn't a cheerleader for whatever happens in the Beltway there in Washington knows that. I'm more interested in getting at what the problem here is. The scientists, most of them, the overwhelming majority of them, have been telling us now for quite a while that we've got to deal with climate change, with global warming, with the consequences of burning fossil fuels that we've been doing in record amounts for so long, et cetera, et cetera. They write the papers, they give the talks, they hold the conferences. We know what the problem is. Likewise, we all know, even the more skeptical amongst us, that this is a problem that is now so long in the making and so big that it needs a coordinated, massive response in which you mobilize public and private resources. And you do that single-mindedly to deal with the problem. Because if you don't, it is going to hurt you very badly, as you hinted at with the very headlines you read a few moments ago. To give you a parallel, over the last 16 months, we have an example. The world was confronted by a very dangerous virus. Every society had to recognize, some did it sooner, some took a while, that you need to mobilize your private and public resources in a systematic, coordinated way to deal with this kind of a problem effectively. The United States failed to do that in the first year. And so it paid a horrific price. The population of the United States is 4% of the world's people. But the number of deaths from COVID that happened to American citizens was 20% of the world's population. This is a statistic that will forever document system failure. You had a president, but not just Mr. Trump. You had a Congress, but not just them. You had a society that was structurally incapacitated. It could not mobilize its resources. We had the resources to make the tests and to test everybody. We had millions of unemployed people who could have been trained in 2 weeks how to administer and record the testing of our population. We didn't do it. We have more than enough factories to produce the masks. We didn't do it. We have more than enough facilities to reorganize public education so that our children could have been shifted from a normal classroom to a different space, properly socially distanced, one teacher for every 3 or 4 students, so it could be done safely. We could do that. We have the people, the unemployed teachers, number in the hundreds of thousands in this society. Every restaurant virtually was closed, could have been, should have been converted into a classroom, and on and on and on. I can't go through the details, but I'm listing everything we could have done, but we failed to do. For me, this is an indictment of a system. Something happens in this system that prevents people from doing what the obvious, clear scientific danger tells us we should do. And I'm not talking about for some abstract objective, but to save the lives of our mothers, our daughters, our sons, and on and on and on. Same thing with global warming or with climate change. So here is what I think is the problem. And that's why I love to discuss this. We have a system in which all of the productive apparatus, the enterprises that produce the goods and services without which our country and this whole planet could not survive, the food, the clothing, the shelter we need as a community. It's done in the factories, in the offices, and in the stores that comprise our enterprises. If we're going to mobilize our resources to meet the threat of a virus or to meet the threat of global warming, then we have to mobilize those resources to those ends. But capitalism doesn't work that way, and that's why it's the problem. What capitalism does is say to every factory, to every office, and to every store, this is your quote unquote bottom line. This is your priority. This is your objective. And that is profits. You're in the business to end up with more money at the end than you threw into the process at the beginning. You know, you bought the machines and you bought the raw materials and you hired the workers and you spent whatever it was, X dollars. And the whole goal and purpose is to come out with Y dollars, where Y is a larger number than X. And the difference is the profit you made by undertaking this activity. All right, here's the problem. Maximizing profit, prioritizing profit, is not identical to defeating a virus or to coping with climate change. It's a different objective. And it is weird, right up to the point of downright crazy, to respond to something as existentially threatening as a virus or as climate change by insisting that you're going to continue to prioritize something else. The only thing weirder than that is to be surprised that your capitalist system didn't do a good job with the virus or didn't do a good job with the climate problem. There's no surprise. You've set it up that way. Here's my last point. I try to talk to workers, and the reason is it's the same there. The vast majority of people in every enterprise are the employees, the people who come to work. The small minority in every enterprise are the employers, the board of directors, the family that owns the business, whatever it is, the major shareholders. So to say that a business is in the business of making money, or to teach, as economics professors like me do, that profit is the logical objective of the system, now let me translate that, that the goal and purpose of the system is to produce the most profits, which happen to be the portion of the output that goes to the minority of employers. Mm-hmm. It's not to maximize what goes to the majority of the people in every enterprise, who are the employees. They don't get the profit. They get the wages and the salaries, but they don't get the profits. So when you tell me profit is how we have to organize the enterprise, the reaction of the working class should be, what are you talking about? I don't want to work in an enterprise whose point and purpose, whose priority is to deliver the best possible outcome to somebody other than me. What am I doing here? What is this? This is the literal opposite of democracy. A tiny minority sitting at the top, an autocracy, has organized an economic system to serve it. It doesn't serve the mass of people. It doesn't mobilize to fight COVID, and it doesn't deal with climate change. So if you want to deal with those kinds of problems, if you're committed to defeating COVID, if you're committed to dealing with the climate, if you take democracy seriously, you're confronted with the following reality. You don't like capitalism, and you believe we can and should do better. And this shouldn't be some ideological, this is a simply logical inference.
Well, and I think there's, and again, we're talking with Professor Richard Wolff, I think there's another inference to be made too, which is that under the current system, you have to accept that you are dispensable. That whenever there's a conflict between profit and your existence, your survival as a human being, as a living organism, whenever those two come in the slightest conflict, your right to exist will be taken away without a second thought. Am I exaggerating or?
No, I mean, we have a fancy name that tries to say what you just said, but hiding the harsh, sharp edges. And the word is automation. I mean, the history of capitalism is the history of the employer deciding that it is more profitable in a situation to replace a human being who's working with a machine that can do that work faster or better or with fewer use of inputs or whatever it is. And then this employer goes to those workers that are being automated and tells them on a Friday afternoon, don't come back here Sunday morning. You are fired. Let go. Whatever words you want. And in that act, the employer is basically saying, I don't know and I don't care and I don't give a damn. Even if I'm a nice guy who goes to church on Sunday and means what he says there, he basically is saying to you, I'm taking your job, I'm taking away your income, I'm taking away your self-respect, your self-esteem, I'm throwing you under these conditions back onto your family where you will have to announce to your spouse, to your children, to all folks dependent on you that you cannot provide for them in the way that you could, on the damage, physical, mental, being done here is incredible. And it's all justified, not only by the employer, you might understand that, but even by the media, by the politicians, by the academics like me, who go around putting lipstick on this hideous hog without saying, hey, this is awful. Should we not be asking the question? You know, there were these people early in English capitalism who got so upset in the face of automation that they went around at night, went back into the factory where they had been replaced with machines, and they destroyed the machines. We're all supposed to giggle, and we're all supposed to make fun of them because they didn't understand progress. Well, I beg to differ. I think they understood perfectly well. They were saying, wait a minute, we have to count in this equation. When you replace us with machines, there are all kinds of consequences which the society is going to have to take into account. I like to explain to people that there are loads of studies that I can show you that when you throw people out of work, for example, because of automation, those people have more alcohol problems than if you didn't. They have more marital problems. Their kids have more difficulty in school. They will be visiting doctors and therapists. When you add up the social cost, you would have been way better off keeping them on the job, paying them, because the sacrifice in profits you wouldn't get is a lot smaller than the costs you're gonna have to incur by the consequences of what you did. So when people tell me, isn't capitalism efficient? I say, no, absolutely not. Most of the time, it's inefficient, and you shouldn't take that argument any more seriously than you take the argument that maximizing profit is some economic law that is justified by anything other than the greed of the minority who are the ones who gather the profit into their hands.
You know, Richard Wolff, I have so many thoughts about what you just said, one of which is, you know, we forget sometimes how much we forget. And we forget the kind of moral anesthesia we're put under so much of the time in order to accept the status quo. And, you know, I think, for example, and I'm going to have multiple thoughts, but I can't pursue them all at once, these threads. One of the thoughts that occurs to me is, for example, when an Elizabeth Warren says, I'm a capitalist down to my bones, when a Nancy Pelosi says, we're capitalists and just that's just the way it is, when a lot of nice and good, decent voters out there say, well, I guess I'm a capitalist, I'm not sure people even understand what they're really saying. And I've wanted to talk to you about this for a long time, and this is a good time to do it, because to me, to say that there is a world in which capital exists as a phenomenon, there is a world in which people invest money to have others do the work and to reap the profits for themselves, is an observation about the world as it functions today. To put the IST ending on it, to say I am a capitalist, is to declare my ideology is that that form of economic structure is the best way to govern humanity. There is no better way to run an economy. And in fact, just as a person in a religion believes the tenets of that religion, I embrace this as a religion, as a faith, as the best way. You know, I feel a lot of people who kind of casually say I'm a capitalist are either cynical or have no idea what they're really saying. And I'd love your thoughts about that.
Well, you know, I have thought about it all my life too, because in a sense, my job has been, since I've been a professor all my adult life, my job has been to be a professor of economics. And that means, among other things, to teach people what the system is under which we all live and function, which is the capitalist system. And my colleagues have the same charge as I do. So, you know, over countless coffees and countless lunches, my colleagues and I in the various universities where I've done this work, we compare notes like working people always do. How's it going in your class? What are the students finding easy? What are the students finding difficult? Because I can use that information to make my effectiveness in the classroom greater, just as they can. So I've been thinking and talking about it. Here's my conclusion after a lifetime of doing this. And I don't mean any disrespect. I'm trying to be as honest as I know how. The level of economic literacy in this country is, and there's no nice way I know how to say this, abysmal. Large numbers of people never take a course in economics. Large numbers of people who take a course take one or two. It is not taught very well. It is not a very interesting topic. And it goes in one proverbial ear and pretty much out the other. And so when you end up asking people questions, it's really upsetting. And if I have had in my life any skill, any success, it has been because I worked so hard right to this minute to make understandable this subject, to overcome that low literacy rate by taking ideas that between you and me are not that complicated, undoing the jargon that they're wrapped up in so that the basic ideas, which every reasonably intelligent man, woman, or child can perfectly well grasp and make them available so that they can understand them and use them. One of the things never taught, and I mean, I'm using never loosely, almost never to be precise, is how to understand what capitalism is and how it's different from other systems. This is something that ought to be part of the basic education. It's like teaching a person, you know, what is an automobile and how is it different from a horse and buggy and how is it different from a motor scooter and how is it different from a bicycle? I mean, these are basic, these are all, you know, ways of moving human beings and moving material, but they're different and they use some things in a similar way. And yeah, that's part of learning how you differentiate things from one another. So when I explain to people that capitalism is a particular economic system, I get already the fuzzy face, the dead giveaway in most students that they understand the words I'm using, but they don't quite get how it adds up. And I learned over the years that I have no right to get angry. No one ever helped them. No one ever introduced it. So it's not reasonable to be upset with them. It's not a fault of the individual I'm talking to. It's a fault of a system that has let that individual down. And let me be very concrete. Some people look at me and say, oh, capitalism, that's when I can start my own business. I then have to stop and explain to them that people were able to start their own funeral business all over the place. And people were able to start their own slave business all over the place. Starting your own business and running it has nothing uniquely to do with capitalism. I tell them about socialist and communist societies, which have all kinds of mechanisms that enable people to start and build a business. So this idea is wrong. Then they give me the next one. Well, I want capitalism. I like it because it rewards initiative. And I mean, at that point, I have to be very careful not to let my face give me away. And then I explain to them how lots of other societies reward initiative. This is not a new idea. 5,000 years ago, Plato and Aristotle talked all about initiatives and how and why a society needs to reward it to make progress, which they were doing, and on and on. So at the end, when we get through all the mistakes like that, I try to focus on what is the difference. And then I explain to them, slavery, feudalism, and capitalism are three different systems. One of them organizes the roles the people can play as master or slave. The other one organizes the role as lord and serf. Still another one, capitalism, organizes it as employer and employee. Those are three different systems, radically different. In slavery, one person can own the other. The master can own the slave. In feudalism, you can't, but the worker is stuck in the place where he or she is born. That's in capitalism, you're not anybody's property and you're not stuck. You are, quote unquote, free. Yeah, but notice that they're also similar in that the small minority, masters, lords, and employers, make all the basic decisions and accumulate the wealth and power in a way that the slaves, serfs, and employees never do. Okay, so what's distinctive about capitalism is this dichotomy, the small group of employer, wow. And then I can introduce, here's the idea of socialism, Jack. It's we do away with the dichotomy, not just the one employer-employee, but no lords and no serfs and no masters and no slaves. That we're going to democratize the enterprise, make it a community, because and everybody has one person, one vote, and we run the enterprise. That would be another alternative. That doesn't say anything about whether you use money or not. It doesn't say whether you reward incentives or not. None of those things, because of course you do all those things. That's not what the distinguishing characteristic is. But I'm not naive. I know that by linking capitalism to other good things, like rewarding initiative, like starting a business, you get people to say, oh yes, I'm a capitalist too, because they want to identify with those good things. It's like saying in capitalism, we honor our mothers. I hope so. I honor my mother. I hope people honor their mothers. But you know, it's got zero to do with capitalism. The irony is that if you really understood capitalism, then there'd be a whole new conversation in this society, and it wouldn't be so loaded, because people have associated capitalism with a whole raft of other things they admire, as I do too. But those are not at stake in moving beyond capitalism, because whatever the next system is, it's going to hold on to that. Just like the slave systems of Rome developed, for example, how to move water. All over Europe, there are beautiful aqueducts built thousands of years ago that work better than the sewer systems built last week. The Romans did. Nobody got rid of that. Everything that has happened since then has learned from and built on the aqueducts built by Roman slaves. What comes next will build on what capitalism did in the same spirit. To go beyond capitalism is not to lose the things that capitalism achieved.
Well, and, you know, this brings up a question that maybe we can only tease today for our next conversation, but that's, you know, once, and that's the word incrementalism. I debated once a very well-known economist, now has very prominent position with the new administration, about Medicare for All. And at one point he said, well, I'm just an incrementalist. That's the way it is. Like, he didn't say capitalist. He said incrementalist, adopting that as a kind of ideology, saying, you know, I want to make slow changes. Now, I don't happen to think you turn a private healthcare system into a public healthcare system this way any more than you turn a bicycle into an airplane by adding more bicycle parts to it. But I think nowhere else but in climate change is it more clear that incrementalism cannot work. We're on a bus headed for a cliff, right, and slightly changing the gradient or the angle of the bus as it approaches the cliff, we're still going to go over. And it seems to me that there is, just as we need to break down what people think they mean by when they say I'm a capitalist, we need to reevaluate this whole concept of incremental change.
Yeah, I agree with you. I'm harsher than you are, RJ, and that's fine. My answer to incrementalism when I hear it is I look at those folks and I say, your best hope to achieve incremental change is if there are people like me out there demanding way more than incremental change. Because if all you're doing is proposing incremental, it's a little bit like a bargaining situation. You go into an open air market somewhere and you want to buy a pair of shoes. And the fellow there says, well, you know, this pair of shoes, you have to pay $100 for this pair of shoes. And you're incremental. And you say, well, I want to get it down, but I don't want to be too radical. So how about 95? And the guy looks at you and says, well, why don't we cut the difference and we'll agree at 97 and a half. My answer is I'm going to offer $30 for the pair of shoes. Let's see where we get then. In other words, there should be no opposition between the incrementalist and the whatever word you want to give to me, because the incrementalist will have a stronger bargaining position to get the incremental change, the more fearful are the folks holding back that if they don't give in to the incrementalist, they're going to have to deal with those of us who have a much bigger agenda that we're pushing. So it's the same old argument as reform and revolution. The best chance for reform is the presence of a loud, large revolutionary movement.
To which I would only add, as someone who really advocates for more revolutionary change, I would only add that when the incremental way fails, as it certainly will with climate change and in other areas, I hope that people will say, well, you know, those people we dismissed as crazy, maybe we better go back and take a second look.
That's right. That's right.
And you so see, I'm sorry, please go ahead.
No, you see it with the COVID. Frankly, I'm very afraid that the things you're saying about the climate are still possible to come and bite us with the COVID. This incrementalism, that means that even as you and I are speaking, a vast majority of the world still has not been given vaccines, even though we know how to produce them and we know how to move them and we know how to inject them. This incrementalism, dealing with it, means that the human community in which this virus replicates itself is still doing that. And the notion that we who have been vaccinated are not going to suffer the return of new variations, I mean, there's a kind of blindness here that is really frightening to observe.
The virus may be evolving more quickly than our understanding of the problem.
Absolutely.
All right. Unfortunately, I know we're going to have to leave it there, but Richard Wolff, economist, host of Economic Update, also democracyatwork.info. As always, thank you for your insights and observations. And as always, thank you for coming on the program.
And thank you, Richard. We have really remarkable conversations. I get emails telling me how much they mean to people. So my hat's off to you. These are opportunities to have the kind of conversations that the old mainstream media shy away from, to their loss. Anyway, thank you, and I look forward to the next one.
As do I, and I value these conversations very much. I'm Richard RJ Eskow, and we'll be right back after this on The Zero Hour.